University of Colorado, and then residency and fellowship training in developmental pediatrics and disabilities in Los Angeles and Sacramento, California. She has been a faculty in the Department of Pediatrics for University of Colorado School of Medicine for 10 years and works in the section of developmental pediatrics at Children's Hospital Colorado. Her expertise is on the diagnosis and treatment of children and adults with genetic causes of developmental disabilities, including Fragile X syndrome, sex chromosome disorders such as XXY, Klinefelter syndrome and triple X syndrome, 22q deletion syndrome, and many more. Dr. Tartaglia will present background information about medical and nursing care for Fragile X across the lifespan, behavioral features of Fragile X, and discuss current research on clinical trials of medications targeting the cognitive and behavioral deficits in Fragile X and other disabilities. She will also present a summary of research from the Denver Fragile X Clinic, analyzing nursing and social work needs for this population. So please help me welcome Dr. Tartaglia.
Should have Fragile X DNA testing. X chromosome. Fragile X is caused by a mutation in a gene on the X chromosome that's called the FMR1 gene. FMR stands for Fragile X mental retardation. And then the protein that's made by that gene is the Fragile X mental retardation protein. This terminology was assigned when we were using the term MR, and so from a genetic aspect, that hasn't been changed because otherwise it causes too much confusion in the genetic literature. So in that gene, as you guys remember, all the DNA code is made of all the little base pairs, cytosine, guanine, adenine, and so in that gene, there's a little area of repeats that are called CGG repeats. So it goes cytosine, guanine, guanine, cytosine, guanine, guanine. And that little CGG repeats multiple times in the gene in the normal setting. Typical individuals have anywhere between 5 and 54 CGG repeats. So if you don't have Fragile X syndrome, you're going to get 5 to 54 CGG repeats in that gene. The gene itself, like I said, makes FMRP protein. That protein is really, really important in brain development, in synapse formation, and in ongoing synaptic plasticity over time. So, you know, the connections between the synapses and ongoing learning and memory, even in adulthood, relies on FMRP. All of our brains are using FMRP all the time. And so it is a very important protein, not just for Fragile X syndrome, but for all of us all the time for learning and memory. So if we think about the difference, it's always important to, a lot of people attribute and think about males who have Fragile X syndrome. Males are generally more affected with Fragile X syndrome because they only have one X chromosome. And so if their FMR1 gene doesn't work and they're not making FMRP protein correctly, then they don't have any of that protein. Compared to females who have two X chromosomes, so usually if they have Fragile X syndrome, one of their X chromosomes is affected, the other one is not. It is a normal copy of the gene that makes normal amounts of protein. And so they have a balance of some of the normal amount of protein. So usually females with Fragile X syndrome are less affected as a group compared to males, but there still are, you know, rates of intellectual disability and autism in females with Fragile X as well. But then some females with Fragile X don't even know they have it until they have a kid with Fragile X. And so there's a lot of variability in terms of the spectrum of what we see in females with Fragile X. So just talking about some of the physical features that we might see, this is some pictures of some pretty classic kids who have physical features of long face, long ears, and then prominent ears with cupping. So this little guy here you can see has really smooth pinna and really prominent ears there. A high arch palate, and I'll show you a picture of that also. A lot of times with a prominent chin, like that little guy over there. And so these are all, different kids who have, you know, some of the more classic features that we would see in Fragile X syndrome. But compared to some other genetic disorders, not everybody has this really classic phenotype, and some individuals with Fragile X syndrome don't necessarily have all of these facial features. So one of my biggest pet peeves is when residents or other people that we're working with will say, oh no, I didn't test him for Fragile X because he didn't look like he had it. Because you definitely can have no characteristic facial features and still have Fragile X. So this is a picture here of the high arch palate that you can see. These are all other individuals with Fragile X. This is a mom and her daughter who have Fragile X syndrome. And so we'll talk about the inheritance of Fragile X, but women, any child with Fragile X syndrome has a mom who's either a carrier of what we call the pre-mutation of Fragile X or the carrier state of Fragile X, or their mom has a full mutation. But by definition, just the way it's inherited, and we'll talk about this, there are any child with Fragile X syndrome, their mother is either pre-mutation or full mutation carrier. So we have a lot of families that we follow in clinic where mom is also affected by Fragile X. Again, sometimes minimally affected, but other times more significantly affected in terms of disability or at least some aspects of learning and cognitive dysfunction. So you can see here these mom and daughter both have some strabismus, which we also sometimes see as one of the medical features. Here's some other individuals again, just to show you again the spectrum of the different features. This is three siblings with Fragile X. So like I said before, it's often inherited. The average age of diagnosis in males is 3.5. So you can think of how many people are either pregnant or have had their second child by the first child being 3.5 years of age, right? And so so there's many situations where there end up being two children or three or more with fragile X in the family because of the delayed diagnosis. And so we all want to push for kind of newborn screening for the sake of getting kids into early intervention, but also for the sake of having families understand their risk of having other kids with fragile X. So here you can see again their ears, but many young men and older men who look totally normal without dysmorphic features. So other physical features of fragile X, a lot of times we'll see hyperextensible joints. This really affects a lot of fine motor skills, especially with handwriting in school, because they just don't get really good grips on their pencils, and they already have motor delays as well. Ankle pronation and flat feet because of, again, a lot of the flexibility in some of the connective tissues, soft, smooth skin, hypotonia or low muscle tone. And then this is kind of a gross old picture, but it's a picture of the enlarged testicles that can happen sometimes in post-pubertal males with fragile X. And so this is a B that we would measure as a normal testicular size. This is the enlarged testicular size, and then the head of the penis right here, if you can't really tell what that picture is. And so that is, as you can see, a significantly enlarged testicle. This can cause a lot of problems in terms of just the weight that causes on the scrotum and having to support that. But in general, they're not usually this big in males. You don't see it until after puberty. So young kids with fragile X would not have enlarged testicles. At this time, there was no gloves, which kind of freaked me out. That's why it's a gross thing. We don't take these pictures off.
This is so good.
And then hyperreflexia, or really brisk reflexes, are also another feature that we see in fragile X. In terms of associated medical problems, we see seizures in about 20% of individuals. Motor or vocal tics are pretty common, and in about 20% of individuals, mitral valve prolapse can happen. Again, because of that loose connective tissue, there can be some difficulties with the mitral valve, and so we monitor for this as guys get older periodically. Strabismus, like we talked about a little bit before, and here's a little girl who has disconjugate gaze and lazy eye in layman's terms, and so that would be classified as strabismus. This is an ear tube inside an ear canal, and so we often see recurrent ear infections and the need for ear tubes, and then constipation as well. In terms of adults with fragile X, thinking about what happens in adulthood, there's very little known. I don't think this slide is in there, so I see a lot of flipping around. I added a few slides and made a few changes, but in general, it'll follow the slides you have, and if not, I'll leave this too if you guys want. So we did do a paper where we looked at about 84 adult males adult males and females with fragile X syndrome to just really try and describe what happens in this adult population and what should we be doing. Most of the research has been on kids, but as this pediatric age group is aging, then we need to know what to do. And so basically, this paper just basically summarized a lot of the medical features that we saw. The most common features were neurologic problems, seizures, tremor, and then about 5% of the sample was actually diagnosed with Parkinson's disease. So as a group, this ended up being about 40%. So in terms of following males and females in adulthood, these are the areas we focus on when we're screening for things. GI problems was another issue. And more specifically, a lot of it was reflux or constipation or chronic kind of loose stools. So most of them very treatable and addressable, but problems that were still present. Obesity in about 30%. This was a little bit higher than the general population, but we do have to always think about how much different are these rates compared to what we see in general population as well. Hypertension was in 25%, and then other heart problems like arrhythmias and other things were in about another 25%. So cardiac follow-up and blood pressure follow-up is also really important part of routine care. When we think going back now to the beginning and talking more about the developmental and psychological behavioral features, developmental delays are usually the first presenting signs in both males and females. The males usually have mean age at first steps about 18 months. Normal is about 12 months of age, so it's not drastically different, but on average it's definitely later, and this is often one of the first concerning signs because they can also have low muscle tone. And then speech delays, the average age of their first words is about 20 months, and then two-word phrases by 3.5, which is significantly delayed because usually that happens between about 18 months and 2 years. So if any of you guys know individuals with Fragile X, it's not just the delay in speech, but it's the content of their speech that's also very unusual and atypical. And the way they learn speech is very different compared to typical children. So they tend to learn in very short, rote phrases that they then will kind of piece together over time. So you hear a lot of what people often describe as kind of autistic types of speech in terms of, you know, lots of use of rote phrases, stereotyped and repetitive speech, a very rapid rate of speech or kind of funny intonation. They'll speak very quickly, or, you know, and then a lot of kind of repetitive phrases in their speech that they use. Intellectual disability and Fragile X syndrome. So in males, it's almost 100%. And the average IQ is about 40 to 50. Oftentimes, they just kind of floor out on the IQ test because it's too challenging for them. And so, on average, it's the mental age of 5 to 6. Now, there's a lot of variability in this. We have some males who are up in the 60s. Very rarely are they in the 70s, and sometimes that's when there's some mosaicism, so they have some cell line without Fragile X in it, and they are making some FMRP. In males, we almost always see intellectual disability, like we said. In females, because of that second X chromosome, we see a lot more variability. And basically, what we usually talk about is kind of a third, a third, and a third. There's a third who meet criteria for intellectual disability, usually not quite as severe in terms of cognitive scores, but definitely in the ID range, and also can have significant difficulties with autism as well. Learning disabilities, and math, specifically math learning disabilities, are more in that kind of second third, so they might not be in the intellectual disability range, but they're still having academic difficulties in math, or ADHD symptoms, and or anxiety, or speech and language delays, so they can have deficits, but not necessarily in the ID range. And then that other third is kind of this, you know, less affected group. Some of the moms might be like, oh, that explains why I never liked math. But they otherwise are professional and made it through school and did really well. So there's this huge spectrum, and it really depends on the amount of FMRP that you make. And so that's kind of the spectrum that we see in females. This is a really cool brain. So they took, this is an fMRI. So it's basically the red parts. They do scanning of the brain while they're in the MRI machine, and the red parts is the blood flow that tells you how active that area of the brain is. And so they were doing mental arithmetic. They had the people in the brain machine, you know, doing like 4 + 4 = 8, or, you know, and some more complicated problem. And in typically developing girls, you can see all these areas that lit up, and then in girls with Fragile X syndrome, it was very much less. And if you looked at actually some of the tasks that were more verbal tasks, they actually lit up more. So math is definitely an area of deficit. In girls with Fragile X and visual spatial skills compared to verbal skills are usually more effective. Okay, so here's some of the behavioral features, and here's some pictures actually of two brothers and others with hand flapping and hand biting, showing some of these behavioral features. Hand biting, hand flapping, sensory sensitivities in terms of auditory, tactile sensitivities. Anxiety is a huge part of the phenotype of Fragile X syndrome and can come along with any of the different types of anxiety symptoms that we often see, obsessive compulsive kind of rituals and routines that they have to follow, difficulties with transition. Selective mutism is common in females where they'll talk, you know, in the home environment where they're comfortable, but then they're silent or almost silent in school environments or other social settings. Being avoidant of eye contact is a big piece, and, you know, honestly, it's one of the areas where people talk a lot about the overlap with autism spectrum disorders, and there is a little bit of discrepancy in terms of that quality of poor eye contact. In Fragile X, you'll see they want to do it, they can't. It's this kind of almost like a sensory true gaze aversion anxiety type of lack of eye contact compared to just like, I'm just not interested in even looking at your face. So there's a little bit of a different quality compared to typical autism. Stereotyped speech, attention and ADHD symptoms really common, especially in young kids. The impulsivity and hyperactivity usually gets a lot better as they get older. And then mood instability, tantrums, aggression, But a lot of this, if you look at it, really comes from anxiety and sensory sensitivity. And so if you can manage those two things, most of the time aggression and other big behavioral issues are really much minimal. Okay, so there, you know, we talk a lot about autism also in Fragile X. And so when you actually do, this was a study where they said, let's look if you do a full autism evaluation on kids with Fragile X, how many actually meet criteria. Because as you saw and heard from all those delays and all the other behaviors, there's a lot of overlap with what we see in autism, right? So when they applied this study, was from when we still had the DSM-4 criteria, but basically 60% of males with Fragile X met criteria for one of the autism spectrum disorders or pervasive developmental disorders, and then 30% had full autistic disorder, approximately 10% of females. And then when you apply the new DSM-5 criteria, it's pretty much the same. It's 60 to 70%. It might even be a little bit higher. And so basically a lot of these kids and adults with Fragile X syndrome will also meet criteria for autism. When they do, we apply the diagnosis because while many people still know about Fragile X syndrome does not qualify you for a lot of the services and supports that the diagnosis of autism will, right? So we say you have Fragile X syndrome. Secondary to Fragile X syndrome, you have autism and or ADHD and or whatever other diagnoses fit under that. Because those are the diagnoses people understand that help them qualify for services, that help educators know what to do in terms of helping to support them. And so any of those other, we call it kind of the alphabet soup, right? Any of those other diagnoses that might fit, if it's going to help support what they need in their treatment planning, then we definitely apply those diagnoses, with the genetic disorder being the medical diagnosis that kind of is the umbrella. So to do testing for Fragile X, so everyone always has questions about, well, how do you diagnose it? You diagnose it through a specific test for Fragile X syndrome. So the doctor or whoever is ordering the test has to be suspicious of Fragile X syndrome and specifically order the DNA test for Fragile X. So any of the other kind of fancy genetic tests like a microarray or chromosome analysis will not pick up any mutation that you see in Fragile X. So this is part of, for any child or adult with intellectual disability, if there hasn't had genetic testing, it's indicated that they have a microarray and Fragile X DNA testing. So we do testing for sure for all children and adults with intellectual disability, all children and adults with autism spectrum disorders, especially if they have developmental delays associated with it. Children who have kind of global developmental delays who aren't old enough yet to meet criteria for intellectual disability. And then females have a milder presentation. And so I, in females, will test any, females who come in with learning disabilities, anxiety, ADHD symptoms, especially if there's any family history of autism or intellectual disability. Just one female who doesn't have any other issue except for ADHD probably would not get a genetic test for a Fragile X, but if there's a lot of it there and it kind of sounds like the phenotype and or you see some physical features or hear about family history, then that's when I would do a test in a female. So implications for nurses related to these kind of the behavioral phenotype is what we see is that, and like I was saying, anxiety and sensory sensitivities are really affect the medical visits. And preparing and understanding that those things are going to happen is really important for kind of getting through a medical visit successfully. Now, anxiety and sensitivities are not uncommon in other disabilities either. And so a lot of the accommodations and supports that we use in general for kids with disabilities are very applicable for Fragile X, but we always, really want to think about the kids. The first time I meet any child with Fragile X, they look way more affected than the second and the third and the fourth time I meet them, because as they're more comfortable, they kind of really chill out. And so, just anticipating that with families. We have one family who comes and just practices. She drives by the hospital, they park, they come in, they sit in their waiting room for a couple minutes, then they leave. And then I'm like, what are you guys doing here? You don't have an appointment. No, we're just practicing. And since she started doing that, like, the visits go so much better because he's just used to coming to clinic now. So So it's much, much better when patients are comfortable and we know what to expect. Transitions, not just in and out of the clinic, but in and out of any facility or, on and off the bus or on and off the, transport to day program or whatever else it is, a lot of times just that transition, even if it's been something they've done all the time, can be really challenging for them. And so having transition objects and things that they're really comfortable with to get them going and keeping as much routine, the same bus driver, the same van, whatever that is, each time so that they don't get that anxiety when it's time to go. We get a lot of calls for, well, we can't get them on and off the bus or on and off, in and out of the, the car. And this is from, childhood all the way up through adulthood. And then, like I was saying before, looking for anxiety and sensory triggers to understand any behavioral difficulty first before attributing it to, a guy who's just aggressive. You can probably do a lot with that environment to help. Okay, so here's some of the fancy genetic stuff. Okay, so typically there's less than 45 CTG repeats in your DNA. Remember that your DNA then is transcribed to make RNA. The RNA is a little code that goes and binds in the ribosome to make your protein, and the protein in Fragile X syndrome is FMRP. So this is what happens typically, and you end up with a normal clinical phenotype. This, in the full mutation, is what we've been talking about. We have over 200 CTG repeats. When that happens, the gene just turns off. It methylates and turns off. And so you don't make any mRNA, and you don't make any protein, and you have Fragile X syndrome, and here's our little guy here. But in the middle is this carrier state that's called the premutation, or the carrier state, and these individuals have 55 to 200 CTG repeats. And so this area is expanded compared to in the typical individual, but the gene is not expanded enough, so it doesn't turn off. Instead, actually, it makes more mRNA than usual, and then it still makes protein, but there are conditions that are associated with the premutation called FAX-TAS that we'll talk about, FAX-POI, and then other psychological features that are more common in the premutation, specifically anxiety and depression. So this is a neurologic syndrome, an ovarian insufficiency, or early menopause, and so we'll talk about these a little bit more too, because it is important in understanding Fragile X families. So this is, like we talked about, the different repeat sizes over here. The premutation actually happens in 1 in 259 females. So that's pretty common. And it's very common in the general population to have a premutation, and not that uncommon in males either, 1 in 810 males. But then the full mutation is much less common. The expansion occurs from a premutation to a full mutation only when it's passed on from mom to the next generation. So a male who has a premutation will not pass it on to his son. He'll pass on the premutation to his daughters. So here's a male with a premutation. He has 125 CTG repeats. This is a family pedigree. So circles are females, squares are males. Black means they have Fragile X syndrome. A dot means they have a premutation carrier state. And so first of all, this shows you basically what can happen in a family, right? Once one person is identified, then there's a lot of other people that you might be able to identify and or inform about their risk of having kids with Fragile X, right? And so a lot of times one of the first steps after diagnosis is doing really good genetic counseling to figure out who is at risk for having kids with Fragile X and who else might need to be tested for Fragile X syndrome, but also for this premutation state related to the risk of having kids with Fragile X and or the risk of some of these premutation-associated conditions that we'll talk about. Here's an example. This girl has 32 and 65, so here's your premutation. She passes along X's, right, to her kids, so any of her kids has a 50% chance of getting one of these two. This one, it expanded, the bad X expanded to 125. Here, it expanded to a full mutation. Here, she passed along her good X that stayed stable. Here's another expanded one. This one was stable, and then this one was expanded. So then when you have a premutation in a male, he only has one X chromosome, he's XY, so all of his daughters get the premutation. It does not expand from male to kids, but then they're at risk of having kids with Fragile X. And then when a female passes it along, depending on the CTG repeat size, it can expand to a premutation or a full mutation. And so this is kind of the genetics of it all, and it seems kind of complicated, but once you really understand the the pattern of inheritance. The genetic counselors are great at going through and just figuring out this person needs to be tested or is at risk. So what does FMRP actually do in the cells, and what happens when we don't have enough, right? This is now going back to talking about that kind of full mutation Fragile X syndrome. Well, it's an RNA binding protein, so it binds to other mRNAs before they're translated, and it's really important in neurons at all stages of development. It's really important in our hippocampus, our learning and memory center, and then it's also in other tissues, including leukocytes, which are white blood cells. That's how we test for Fragile X in the blood, is that we look for the DNA in the white blood cells. So it's handy that it's in there, so we don't have to handle, we don't have to get any other tissues. And then in neurons, what it actually does is it inhibits translation of stimulus-induced mRNA at the synapse. So this is kind of the fancy neuroscience term for basically whenever you have some new learning and memory happening, when those new connections are formed, there's new proteins that are expressed, and the synapse changes when you learn, so that then that new synapse has learned whatever that new connection is, right? And so there has to be some kind of physical change in that synapse, and Fragile X protein is very involved in making sure all the proteins that are involved in that change with the electrical connection happens. They have mouse models of Fragile X where they've actually knocked out the Fragile X gene in mice, so mice don't make FMRP, and then they can do a lot of experiments on the mice to really understand what's happening at these synapses. The Fragile X mice are more anxious, they hide in the corner, they don't learn as well, they have poorer attention spans, they have higher rates of seizures, and so it's very handy to have a Fragile X mouse model to learn, first of all, what happens in some of the brain structure and the synaptic structure, but also because you can then do treatments and then see if their behavioral responses improve, right? So this is actually what happens in Fragile X syndrome to the synapses. So here's a really plump, healthy synapse. You have your presynaptic vesicles. They're going to release your neurotransmitter onto your postsynaptic receptors. And this is a nice, healthy synaptic connection. And this is what it looks like in a healthy mouse. Is that you have all these little dendritic spines, and the synapses get all these connections from all over the place. In Fragile X syndrome, when you don't have FMRP, you have what happens, what's called an overactivation of your mGluR5 pathway. So mGluR5 stands for metabotropic glutamate receptor. So glutamate is one of the big excitatory neurotransmitters in the brain, and when it's overexcited, you actually get loss of these synapses. And so you get these little dwindly, weak synapses that don't work very well. So this is what happens in a lot of the hippocampal cells and the synaptic connections in Fragile X, and explains a lot of the cognitive deficits that we see, because they're just not healthy, plump, active synapses. And this is actually what you see. You get these really long, dwindly spines on the dendrites of the Fragile X mice synapses, and also in humans when they look at human brain slices and stuff. This is what happens. And so this was discovered, actually, I'm going to tell you this, 2004 was the mGluR5 hypothesis of what did we do with this. And we're going to come back to talking about this when we talk about the targeted treatments, because the next question is, well, if it's overactivation of a glutamate receptor, can you block that glutamate receptor and then what?